Before coming to this session, the title of this session is U.S.-Russia relations. Maybe it's U.S., maybe EU, U.S. / and Russia relations. So what is the future? So since the beginning of around December 2013, the relation began to deteriorate between the two countries and the two sides. So, and since the peak was the Crimea annexation, and then Ukraine crisis still going on. So instead of having formal presentation from each speaker, I'd like to pose a question. And also before that, let me introduce the speakers. On my immediate left, Professor Umguo of Hanyang University. And to his right, I think Dr. Svetlana Kopja from RAND Corporation Europe, and Free University of Brussels also. And so we have Dr. Dmitry Suslov from Russia. And last but least, Gil Rosman, Professor Emeritus. So now he's working with us as editor-in-chief and ASEAN Forum. So actually, I'd like to pose just one simple question. What is the cause of confrontation between Russia and the Western powers? So I'd like to start with Svetlana. So, okay. Yep.
Hello. Firstly, thank you very much for inviting me to this forum. It's really a pleasure and honor to be here. It's a really interesting question. I think many of us have been wondering it and debating it for now for some time. Although the panel actually focuses on the U.S.-Russia relations, I come from Brussels, so my perspective is tilted by perspective from Europe, and I'm also originally from Ukraine, although for a big part of my life I've lived abroad. So that also influences my view on the crisis. And what I think I've heard so far when we talk about what has been the cause of the crisis was the fact that Russia felt insecure, right? We heard this in this conference that the fact that NATO has expanded, the fact that Russia felt that Ukraine could be potential NATO member, and the fact that Russia hasn't really become part of that order, it felt that it would have this alliance right on its border. And therefore, one of the solutions also to the crisis that we've heard many times has been the fact that Ukraine may be a buffer state, right? A neutral zone that would actually help to address those insecurities that Russia has had. And to answer that kind of argument, I would say that we need to look at the empirical data. And this was actually part of my PhD, had to do with analyzing Ukraine's foreign policy between 1994 and 2004. And I didn't realize it would be so popular now, actually many years after I'd done that work. And what I found is that actually Ukraine has been a buffer state for almost 24 years. Right, of its post-Soviet independence. There's nothing new in the argument that Ukraine should be a buffer state. Ukraine has been a buffer state. Ukraine hasn't been integrated into the European Union, and Ukraine hasn't had even a membership perspective for NATO. NATO was off the table when we've seen policies from Russia being implemented. And in fact, what we hear a lot of times when it comes to Ukraine is what captures the global headlines, right? And global headlines have been captured by the Euromaidan movement, by when Yanukovych fled the country, and the Crimea annexation. But I followed Ukraine reading national news before that. And the issue of Russia has been on the agenda before that. In fact, it was during the Yanukovych presidency, and he was considered to be a pro-Russian president, that we've seen Russian pressure being put on Ukraine. And the pressure was coming from economic. And as you may very well know, economy actually can be very much a security issue. I've just been to eastern Ukraine last week, and it's interesting, I've spoken to local mayors of the towns that have been also used to be under separatist control, and the local population is wary about its future. One of the things they told me was that in some towns, they're very much depending on factories. And in these factories, for example, in one town I was, there were five factories, and these factories used to have 70% of its orders come from Russia. And even before Yanukovych fled, before the Euromaidan movement, before the association agreement was even on the debating table, Russia started putting pressure, having trade restrictions to these regions, communicating to the people in these regions that they have to decide whether they want to have relationship with Russia or Europe. Now, coming from Brussels, it's been kind of an amazing talking to the economists to what extent this is very much a myth that Europe was forcing Ukraine to choose, because all Ukraine wanted to have was a free trade opportunity with Russia. I think for this region it's especially important the idea of economic development and the role that it can have in post kind of conflict situations. For Ukraine business, the idea of economic integration has been a very, very important one. And therefore, I think what is interesting is actually, I think the root of the cause of the crisis has not been very much the US role, because the US actually didn't have Ukraine high on its agenda. The Obama was very much about resetting the relationship with Russia. The Europe didn't have Ukraine also high on its agenda. It didn't even grant a Ukraine membership perspective, even after the Orange Revolution. And what has become threatening to Russia, I think, is actually the association agreement and the trade component of it.
Okay, great. Thanks for highlighting the actually, unlike this, the commoners' understanding of this crisis, you highlighted the economy. If the trade is the one of the main driver of the situation. Yep. What is your take on this one, Dmitry?
First of all, let me join Svetlana in thanking the ASEAN plenum for inviting me here. It is a big honor to be here. I think that there are systemic and specific reasons for this crisis. The systemic reasons tell us that this crisis was, which is basically not even a crisis, I describe this chill in US-Russia relations as a new period, which will be for a long while, and I tend to describe it as limited systemic confrontation, which means that the relations will be defined by adversarial relations. Cooperation is going to be as an exception and very limited. US and Russia, as I say, perceive themselves as adversaries, and their confrontation is mostly intense in the regions where they intersect most, which is post-Soviet space and Europe, mostly. But at the same time, this confrontation will be limited and is limited, meaning that the sides avoid a full-fledged Cold War, a full-fledged arms race. They try to avoid open and direct military clash, of course. And they do not restructure fundamentally their defense postures and their foreign policy logics. Now, what are the reasons? As I said, they are systemic and specific. Systemic reasons is the fact that, you know, Richard Nixon, after the end of the Cold War, who was alive still there, said that the United States won the Cold War but failed to win the peace. And this is the major systemic reason of the new state of US-Russia relations, because the sides even interpreted the end of the Cold War fundamentally differently. Russia never agreed that it lost the Cold War. And Russia never agreed that it should be taken or regarded as a defeated country. And that Russia stated from the very beginning that it should participate in a full-fledged basis in elaboration and creation of the new post-Cold War international order. So after the end of the Cold War, almost immediately, Russia and the United States fundamentally disagreed about almost all the modalities and components of post-Cold War international order. What should be the relations among great powers and rules of the game among great powers? What should be the international order in Europe and Euro-Atlantic? Should it be based on the expansion of Western institutions, including all the countries into their orbit, including Ukraine, but leaving Russia aside? Or Russia should be a participant in elaboration of a genuine post-Cold War international order, with Russia being one of its pillars? Should the Western institutions expand up to the Russian borders, or there should be limits to those expansions? Does the West have the right to interfere into the affairs of the regions which Russia describes as parts of their vital interests or not, and so on and so forth? Can the West conduct regime change policy worldwide, or there should be a multilateral collaboration and joint decision-making on the issues of the use of force in the world. And these contradictions reflected itself in every each crisis of the U.S.-Russia relations after the end of the Cold War. In Yugoslavian crisis of 1999, Iraq crisis 2003, Russian-Georgian war 2008, and Ukrainian crisis 2014. So the roots are absolutely the same. Moreover, these are not specifically a Russian problem with the United States. The fundamentals of this problem is the same or very similar with the United States, between the United States and all other non-Western major players. We heard yesterday at our yesterday panel that China also wants to have a friendly environment on their borders and is conducting a policy of region building in order to create this Chinese-centric economic environment and non-block security environment around these borders. India is suspicious to the American presence in the Indian Ocean, despite the fact that India is a democracy and a strategic partner of the United States. Brazil is also suspicious to the American policy in Latin America. So the roots, I mean, the policies that the countries conduct are differently, are different, but the roots of this problem are the same, and Russia is not an exception here. Okay. Now, specific, very, very important that I will be very brief. The specificity of Ukrainian question, of the Ukrainian conflict, and its difference to the previous ones, is that this time each side conducted steps which exclude an opportunity of easy reconciliation. The United States supported a vividly anti-Russian transition of power in Ukraine. The problem for Russia is not about Maidan and the will of the Ukrainian people to live like in Europe, you know, to reduce corruption and so on and so forth. The problem for Russia was what Barack Obama described the U.S. brokering power transition in Ukraine. That the United States, from the very beginning, described that the, conducted outright support for the Maidan, and described the situation as the people, you know, against the illegitimate president. That is the problem for Russia.
Okay.
And the U.S. Attempts to consolidate Ukraine on the anti-Russian basis immediately after. Russia, on its side, annexed Crimea and intervened into the civil war in Ukraine. And my final point, the reason for this, for these steps, is that both countries perceive the steps of its opponent as a systemic challenge to itself. Russia regarded the United States already by 2013 as a dangerous interventionist country, which is clinging to the regime change policy worldwide. Libya, Syria were really game changers in the U.S.-Russian reset. And in combination with the other components of the U.S. policy, cancellation of the Obama-Putin summit in September 2013, handling of the Sochi Olympics in the Western media, so on and so forth, the American steps on Ukraine were regarded by the Russian leadership as a war against Russia. So in the Russian perception, it was Russia who was the target of the U.S., and Ukraine was like a tool. And the United States, of course, regarded also the Russian steps as a challenge to the U.S. leadership. Because indeed they regarded the Russian take on Crimea and Donbass as a new norm of Russian foreign policy in the post-Soviet
space. Dmitry, you have more time later.
Yeah, so,
actually, it seems to me that I think I have to put Gil on the spot, because like, Dmitry provoked the U.S. side very much. U.S. U.S. responsibility for all this crisis since the end of Cold War. So it's from starting all these things. So Gil, what is your take on this?
My take is that I agree with the previous two speakers. This crisis is not about Ukraine primarily. It goes much further back. Mm-hmm. It can be traced back to the early 90s. And I also think the crisis is more serious than Dmitry described it as. It's not a limited systemic crisis, I think. It's a fundamental crisis of the nature of the world order. And my emphasis always has been Russia's response to Asia, because the turn to Asia is the way Russia handles this crisis. And since I was an undergraduate major in Chinese and Russian studies, I'd say that is my most compelling interest, what happens between China and Russia to change the policy in Asia? And I see the basic source of this turn to Asia, which is really not a turn to Asia, it's a turn to China. There's no other, unlike Dmitry's view of all the non-Western powers sharing a similar view, I don't see that at all. I see Russia joining China, even wishing that China would give it more support in a kind of alliance relationship right now, which China's resisting, and that this turn to Asia is a very significant long-term step. Now, why does it occur? In my view, it occurs because of the legacy of communist national identity, that whether I look at any of the dimensions, and I had a book that came out on the last year on the Sino-Russian relationship and the identity sources of this relationship. I don't think it's mainly based on national interest. I think it's mainly based on identity. And I think there is a fundamental decision in Putin's part that goes way back before Ukraine. I think it can be summarized as Eurasianism, or it's a resistance. The threat to Russia is Western civilization. Mm. And that this is a threat that goes, it's far-reaching, and therefore this crisis is very difficult to resolve because Russia has decided that China is a much better partner than the United States.
Mm. So based upon my observation of both of you's comments, I have to say I'm so much pessimistic of the future of U.S.-Russia relations, because it is a deep strategic distrust between the two countries drives to the limit. So actually, South Korea is about 4,000 miles away from the European continent. What is the third party? Maybe, I don't know whether it can be regarded as a third party or not. What is South Korea's understanding of this, and also the implication for South Korea?
이 미국하고 지금 러시아 사이의 최근의 갈등은 상당히 근본적인 인식의 갈등입니다. 소련이 붕괴된 이후에 미러 간의 국제 질서에 대한 이제 합의가 없었던 점에서 출발한 갈등이고요. 이때까지 미국의 대러 정책은 포섭과 통제의 정책이었습니다. 러시아가 가급적 시장화되고 민주화된 서구적 국가가 되도록 포섭하면서 대신 러시아의 힘이 너무 강하지 않도록 통제하는 그런 정책을 써왔습니다. 그런데 이제 더 이상 러시아가 국제사회에서 주변적인 국가가 되거나 미국의 단극적인 질서를 더 이상 인정하지 않겠다는 그런 어떤 인식의 갈등에서 온 이제 문제이고요. 메드베데프 대통령 시절의 리셋 외교를 통해서 상당히 성과가 있었죠. 아프가니스탄 문제라든지 이란 문제라든지 뉴스타트 프로그램이라든지 이렇게 있었는데 왜 갑자기 이렇게 미러 간의 갈등이 위기적 상황으로 갔을까? 이제 첫 번째는 과연 푸틴 대통령이 굉장히 반서구적 성향을 가졌기 때문이냐, 이제 소위 푸틴이 악마냐 하는 문제가 있습니다. 미국의 많은 학자들이 지금 유크레인 문제나 나토 확대 문제나 이때까지 코소보 사태 이런 문제가 만약에 러시아가 굉장히 서구적인 민족 국가였으면 갈등이 될 문제가 아니었다. 순전히 푸틴 때문에 이렇게 된 것이다 라고 주장하고 있습니다. 또 다른 학자들은 그것은 원인과 결과를 잘못 파악하는 것이다. 이제 키신저 국무장관이 한 얘기를 좀 들려드리면 푸틴의 악마화는 미국의 정책이 될 수 없다. 그것은 미국이 러시아에 대한 적절한 정책을 갖고 있지 못한 것에 대한 변명에 불과하다는 말이 있습니다. 두 번째는 최근에 미러 간의 경제적 공동의 이익은 굉장히 축소되고 있습니다. 특히 셰일가스 등장 이후에 이제 유럽에서의 러시아 가스 의존도가 앞으로 상당히 낮아질 것이기 때문에 미러 간에는 장기적 에너지 전쟁을 할 수밖에 없습니다. 그런데 지금 미국은 러시아에서의 교육 비중은 작년에 3.6%밖에 되지 않습니다. 러시아에서 미국은 전혀 경제적 파트너가 되고 있지 못합니다. 이제 세 번째 원인은 아까도 얘기가 나왔지만 최소한 구소련 지역에서의 지배성, 러시아의 우위성을 침해당하지 않겠다. 이런 정책이 이제 확고해졌다는 것. 이제 네 번째는 굉장히 국내 정치적 요인이 이런 대외 정책에 많은 영향을 미치고 있는 것 같습니다. 마그니스키법이나 이런 인권법, 또 소치 올림픽 때 이런 동성애법 금지, 이런 국내적 요인들이 상당히 이 대외 정책에도 영향을 미치고 있기 때문입니다. 한반도에서 미러 관계를 저희가 이렇게 주목하고 있는 것은 이 한러 관계가 최근에 굉장히 미러 관계에 동조화되고 있기 때문입니다. 한국과 러시아가 해결해야 될 또 많은 공동의 이익이 있음에도 불구하고 미러 관계의 악화가 바로 한러 관계의 발전의 제약 요인으로 작용하고 있기 때문에 이 미러 관계의 향배는 한국의 입장에서도 굉장히 중요한 implication을 가지고 접근해야 될 그런 문제라고 생각합니다.
네, thank you. So, Svetlana, so because you are representing the European continent, so what is your take on this? Actually, Dimitri's and also Gil's points about some pessimistic view for the future of U.S.-Russia relations. Because actually, when I attended the Brussels Forum this March, actually, I found a very profound pessimistic view for the future, and also maybe some country argued we have to upgrade the military force posture, and also by spending up to 2% of GDP on defense, and especially NATO countries are forcing to modernize the forces and bring in more missile defense systems. So is that a consensus among the European countries on this policy? Or is there some yes. diversity on that?
Yes, so I also wanted to quickly address one of the points I heard, because we've heard that, okay, it's not really about Ukraine, and I think there's partly truth to that, because I think we need to separate the two types of crises that are happening. One is that crisis between Russia and the U.S., and I think the grievances have been there for some time predating the crisis. I take those points. But I think when you really analyze Ukraine, when you do, you know, analyze Ukrainian language-based sources, we'll go to Ukraine and really try to understand the logic, what is there. There's another crisis there. And I think that we really need to look at it with evidence-based view, not just comparing Ukraine across the world everywhere. There are certain dynamics within Ukraine that make that drive the domestic factors. For example, just one quick example. We've had Leonid Kuchma in power as a president for 10 years. From 1994 until 2004. Also President, former President Yanukovych, they were all elected on largely pro-Russian electoral platform, drawing on the electorate from the East. They were originally from the East as well, of Ukraine. But when they were elected to power, shortly after that, they vehemently pursued European and Euro-Atlantic integration in their speeches. Maybe they haven't done the reforms, because actually there was no true membership again perspective from the EU or from NATO. Just wanted to remind those things. There was no, Ukraine has been a buffer state. But they've pursued that statements in the policy. Why is that so? Why are leaders that are, you know, considered to be pro-Russian, once they are elected, they pursue EU integration policy. And you really have to then look into Ukraine-Russia relations, not just Russia-US relations. And when we look closely at the relations between Ukraine and Russia, what has been there for some time, dating even to the negotiation of the friendship treaty between Ukraine and Russia that was signed in 1997, that took a while to sign and there were really rough patches, Yeltsin canceling visits to Ukraine, there has always been insecurity that Ukrainian leaders felt in dealings with Russia. Statements that Ukraine is really kind of like, just like us, this is almost an extension of Russia, parts of Ukraine territory used to belong to there. Imagine if you live in a house and your neighbor keeps saying, you know, your house used to belong to me, and actually I may want to have some stuff back. You know, you really wouldn't feel, you probably would want to have an alarm system in your house, right? This is only a natural thing to do. So the point is that these leaders, especially when I analyzed Kuchma's speeches in 1993 before he was elected, he kept saying that Western world was there to exploit Ukraine. In 1996, he was the one who was saying, we are the European state, we need to pursue European integration, and you have to really kind of understand the dynamics. And in fact, well, we don't have time, I would quote you a few other things, but that's one point. The other point is that, you know, when the crisis in Ukraine occurred, and even in 2004, I've done a lot of interviews with EU officials, and including with the ones who were involved in negotiations with Russia and Ukraine, and I've asked them, Have you really tried to exclude Russia? What about the European neighborhood policy? That's the main policy that governed relationship between Ukraine, as well as Georgia, Moldova, Armenia, Azerbaijan, and the southern neighbors. And one of the things that they said was, firstly, no, Russia was invited to be part of the European neighborhood policy. Russia declined because it wanted to have a special status. Fair enough, Russia is bigger. It actually inherited lots of the Soviet Union stuff, so fine, it's more important. And that was the kind of relationship. Russia was always considered to be more important compared to these post-Soviet states. Ukraine was put in the basket with other, also northern African states, into the neighborhood policy. The neighborhood policy was designed to avoid countries becoming members. Again, it was designed actually because of the fatigue with the enlargement.
Okay. Yes.
Just one quickly. So in fact that, now, if Russia was feeling insecure, then just a few points to think about it. One is that NATO has only become reinvigorated after what happened in Ukraine.
Mm.
So if the policy was to contain NATO, well, it's not really working because the discussions that are here in Brussels with NATO, it has a whole fresh wind of energy coming into this idea that it really has to be serve as collective defense organization. So I don't think that's working. The second thing, I was just in Eastern Ukraine and talking also, and I have people who I know also who are now in the separatist areas. And what I hear is that when you have a territory that is not really under firm accountability and control, you have certain things happening. Drug trafficking, human trafficking. People know that they may be pardoned as part of this kind of reconciliation thing. So terrible things can happen during that time. We've all know, even in this part of the world, that history and when there is war, terrible things happen. So if Russia wanted to have security, then it certainly creates a whole range of border that is quite insecure, I would say. I think that Russia has a special romantic almost relationship with Russia that actually is not really driven by pragmatic. So I think that the analyzing Russia-US is one thing, but when it comes to Ukraine, the US point is actually a distraction. Because what Russia has been trying to do so far is to prevent Ukraine from pursuing economic and people-to-people integration with Europe, because that changes also society.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that has been one of the policies that that Russia has been trying to do. And at the same time, within the debates about Ukraine, the US card was thrown in. And I've traveled in different capitals in just last thing in Europe. And when you sit in Berlin or sit in Paris, there's all these debates about US, US, US. But you know what? If you go on the ground to Ukraine, US matters more. It was more about Europe than the US. The US actually wanted for Europe to take ownership of its neighborhood. It's Chancellor Merkel and President Hollande who is negotiating Minsk agreement. It's not Obama or Kerry flying in there. So this is one of the points that I think is really misguided. And it's fun to discuss in geopolitical forums, but evidence-wise, I don't think it makes sense.
But actually, for example, the Europeans are arguing for people think to Europe again, to the United States.
About what?
The people to Europe instead of people to Asia. So actually, when the people to Asia was announced by the Obama's administration, actually Europeans were really afraid of the maybe the U.S. is going to be put more emphasis on the Asia Pacific instead of this.
Yes.
But actually, now the trend is reversed. Actually,
well,
because
there is a war in Europe. Mm-hmm. But actually, what many in Ukraine wished, if you do interviews with business elites, with political elites, even with military. Firstly, the hardest thing, we asked them, what was the hardest thing as a result of this crisis? Most people in the military says, realizing that Russia became an enemy. Imagine if you were in the Soviet military, you always trained that the West is the enemy. Now, all of a sudden, psychologically, to understand that Russia is an enemy, it's been extremely difficult. And when you interview business elites, most of them say, we wish truly that Russia also pursued Lisbon to Vladivostok idea of free trade. Mm-hmm. We want to have people-to-people contacts. We want to have free trade.
Okay,
we don't really want to have trade wars.
Okay. Professor,
예, 그 여기 주한 우크라이나 대사님도 와 계시는데요. 이 우크라이나 문제와 미러 관계를 좀 이제 명확하게 저희가 좀 한번 생각해 볼 필요가 있습니다. 지금 이제 NATO 말씀하셨는데. 지금 네이토는 역사상 최소 규모의 육군이고 2차 대전 이후 최소 규모의 해군을 갖고 있습니다. 28개 회원국 중에서 GDP 대비 2% 이상 국방비를 지출한 국가는 미국, 영국, 뭐 그리스 뭐 이 정도밖에 되지 않고요. 지금 제가 뭐 수슬로프 박사님이 이제 한번 말씀해 주시겠지만 저희 판단에 과연 네이토가 이런 러시아에 대한 이제 정말 대항에 대해서 정치적 의지를 갖고 있느냐, 그건 아마 러시아 쪽에서도 그렇게 네이토가 확고한 의지를 갖고 있다고 판단하지는 않을 것입니다. 두 번째는 지금 이제 우크라인 문제를 많이 말씀하셨지만 지금 지정학적으로 볼 때 이 동부 우크라이나는 이미 셔터벨트 아주 그 강대 국가의 분쟁 지대가 이미 되고 있습니다. 이것은 더 이상 굉장히 악화되지는 않겠지만 솔루션을 찾기가 굉장히 이제 어렵고 굉장히 장시간 이제 분쟁이 지속될 그런 장기적 셔터벨트가 되고 있고 이것은 결국은 미러 간의 관계가 단기적으로는 해결되기 어렵다는 하나의 가장 전형적인 사례가 될 것입니다. 더더욱이 지금 이 동부가 이 피보트 아시아의 문제는 굉장히 복잡해지고 있습니다. 과거에는 뭐 미중 간의 어떤 그 밸런스 문제만 있었지만 이제 러시아도 미국 유럽의 시장이 에너지 시장이 악화되면서 러시아도 이제 피보트 아시아를 원합니다. 또 러중 관계를 활용한 반미 전선이라는 구축이 상당히 지정학적인 중요한 이익이 되고 있습니다. 그렇기 때문에 과연 아시아와 유럽에서 동시에 미국이 러시아에 대항해 나가는 그런 힘을 가지고 해나갈 수 있느냐, 그것은 조금 퀘스천이 될 수 있고 결론적으로 말씀드리면 이제 동부 우크라이나 문제는 셔터벨트로서 우리가 접근해야 된다. 저는 좀 그런 말씀을 드리고 싶습니다.
Okay, Dmitry.
Thank you. Just several points in responding to what the colleagues were saying. First, Russia's aggression. You know, there is, I think, a fundamental misreading of the logic of the Russian policy towards the West. Many people consider Russia as an expansionist, revisionist country who is revising, you know, the Western order. I don't think so. I don't think it is true. Russia, in my understanding, is tactically revisionist in order to promote strategic status quo. Right? Russia has been historically trying to fix status quo in relations with the West and was defending the status quo when the status quo was broken by the West through the Western-led expansion of the Western order. NATO and European Union to the Russian borders. Russia is not trying to question NATO as such. Russia is not trying to question the membership of, let's say, Baltic states in NATO. Russia would be a revisionist power if Russia would claim, you know, Baltic states, come back, right? We disagree with your membership in NATO. We disagree with Polish membership in NATO and the European Union. Let's restructure it fundamentally. Actually, Russia was more revisionist power in the 1990s than today, because in the 1990s, Russia was arguing exactly this thing. Now, Russia is claiming that our perception of the order is the following, that Russia should be one of the centers of the integral Euro-Atlantic-Eurasian-Asian, wider, broader international order. So Russia should be one of the pillars of this order, but this order should not be overtaken by the West, right? It should find its place in this wider context. I would not agree with Gilbert that Russia is afraid of the Western civilization and regards the Western civilization as a threat. No, Russia is a member of the Western civilization. And if you look even into the Minsk agreements and the declarations that was attached to the Minsk agreements, there is spelled out commitment to the common economic and humanitarian space from Lisbon to Vladivostok. So Russia is still committed to strategic partnership with the European Union. Russia is even claiming that re-establishment of strategic partnership with the U.S. is possible and even required as soon as the U.S. accepts the terms. Right? The problem is about the terms, not about the desirability of those partnerships. The other thing is that the U.S. will not accept those terms in the observable future. This is why I'm pessimistic about the future of U.S.-Russia relations. Russia's turn to China versus turn to the Pacific. Again, I can't agree. Russia's turn to pivot to Asia was proclaimed much before the start of the U.S.-Russian confrontation, and it's not a result of the crisis of U.S.-Russia relations. It's the result of the change of distribution of power in the world. Pacific is becoming the center of gravity of world economy and world politics, so it is absolutely logical for a great power as Russia to turn there in order just to be one of the leaders of the world. Mm. And we already have strong strategic partnership with China. It's impossible, by the way, I also can't agree with the Korean panelist, it's impossible to establish alliance with China. Right? Impossible, simply, because of the logic of the Chinese foreign policy and because of the logic of the Russian foreign policy. Right? Who will be number one in this alliance? Right? Russia will never be number two and China will never be number two. Actually, I also disagree that Russia is becoming number two in the current Russian-Chinese establishment. No, it is an equal strategic partnership, and who needs more, whether Russia needs China more than China needs Russia more, it's a question to be discussed. You know?
Okay.
It's more or less equal. So Russia wants to establish, to deepen partnership with the countries like Korea, Japan, Vietnam. You know, Vietnam is having a territorial dispute with China, but Russia is supplying arms to Vietnam. Moreover, I think one of the major recommendations would be for U.S.-Russia relations is that there should be a tacit agreement between Russia and the United States and even a tacit understanding and dialogue about desirability to deepen economic and political cooperation between Russia and American allies and partners in Asia-Pacific, including South Korea, including Japan, Philippines, Vietnam, and the others. Mm. Why? Because the current U.S. policy of limiting and preventing this partnership is understandable according to this confrontational logic, but it is absolutely counterproductive. It is short-sighted. Why? Because if the U.S. limits this Russian outreach to the countries as South Korea, it makes China more powerful. Mm. And China is still the major rival to the United States and Pacific, not Russia. It allows China to dominate development of Siberia and Far East. It compels Russia, you know, to support China more vigorously in the Chinese policy in Asia-Pacific. Is it really in the interest of the United States? Is it really in the interest of the countries as Korea? I don't think so. So we need to find some common understanding here and unbundle the agenda of U.S.-Russia relations, I mean, in Europe and post-Soviet space on the one hand, and in Asia-Pacific, transnational threats and challenges on the other hand.
Okay, thank you. Actually, this is, you made a two important two points. One is who is the revisionist power? They say it's the U.S. or Russia. That's one. Actually, it seems to me you provoked my Chinese colleague a lot. So what would I like to ask my Chinese colleague to answer, what is your take on this relations? First of all, I'd like to ask Gil to make some comments. What is your take on this? Who is actually the revisionist power?
The what kind of power?
Yeah, who is the revisionist?
Oh, the revisionist power.
So is it Russia or the U.S.?
Because who's the revisionist power, Russia or the U.S.? Well, I think that if you take the post-Cold War era and you take Obama's reset to Russia and his enthusiasm for improving relations, I think you could even call it some blamed him for a kind of pivot to Russia. We've heard pivot to Iran this morning. Then I would say that the U.S. was hoping for a constructive cooperative relationship. I think that Russia's long-term thinking is that this world order that has emerged is unsatisfactory for Russia. Mm. What Dmitry has just said is it's consistent with what I've read in Russian sources. I find it contradictory. Mm. It's what Russia presents. They have an equal relationship with China. They are eager to improve relations with Japan and South Korea, but what I see happening is they won't make the compromises and the overtures, and if they did put military aggression off the table in Europe and there was a change in Russia's stance without necessarily giving up some of their goals in Ukraine, I think that would make a big difference. And so the fact that Abe is not going to Moscow and Park is not going to Moscow, I think it suggests a kind of minimal solidarity in the face of a kind of rather a continuing crisis situation. Mm. And if Russia didn't want to rely heavily on China and didn't have to concede that the Silk Road economic belt is really the big framework, and the Russian Economic Union is the small framework that's fitting within it, essentially, now, then Russia would have a lot more options in Asia. And I think the U.S. should be encouraging, if Russia makes similar, the proper overtures, Japan and South Korea, and the U.S. itself, which long thought that Russia and the U.S. had common interest in Siberia and the Russian Far East and this region. But now I think the Russia position has shifted so significantly, including its support for North Korea. And I bring this all up in identity terms, because when I read sources about Russian civilization, on every theme of civilization that I think is important, they are not part of the West. They say they're part of the West, but when you look at their criticisms of what Western civilization has become today, what Western civilization did historically to Russia, the line is very sharp. And that's, I think, Putin's overall effort to draw the line so Russia becomes one of the centers of the world again, reestablishes its sphere of influence, including Ukraine and a broader interest, and now sees China as the only way to do that. And because of this heavy reliance on China, there's no probability that it's going to make serious overtures to China's neighbors. And the situation in Vietnam, I think, is just a minor anomaly, and it's not causing serious concerns anymore.
Okay, I'd like to ask Professor because actually he posed about this Russia, China, and it's kind of interesting questions, also points of. Professor what is the South Korea? This is kind of dilemma for South Korea. 네.
러시아 중국의 관계는 이제 저희가 그 convenient marriage 관계라고 편의적인 결혼 관계라고 우선 생각을 해볼 수 있겠습니다. 지금 이제 경제적으로 보면 이제 앞으로 향후 한 20년 이내에 러시아는 이제 유럽에 보내던 가스를 이제 중국이나 아시아 시장에 이제 팔아야 될 것입니다. 이제 그 작년에 4천억 달러의 그 가스 협상이 있었고 또 이제 2,800억 달러 정도의 알타이 프로젝트도 지난번 G20에서 APEC에서 상당한 진전이 있었습니다. 근데 군사적으로 보면 현재 중국의 핵무기는 대략 한 300기 정도밖에 되지 않기 때문에 또 지금 이제 최근에 미일 방위협정 이제 변화 또 이제 최근에 이제 군사비 뭐 이제 지출 증대 등을 보면 역시 중국과 미국 간의 군사적 비대칭은 오히려 좀 더 벌어지고 있는 상황입니다. 따라서 중국은 역시 독자적인 어떤 군사적 행동 대립을 하기가 상당히 어렵고 그런 면에서 보면 이제 미국 러시아는 소위 말한 이제 아시아에서 일종의 미국에 대한 node of tension 긴장의 어떤 교점을 중국이나 북한을 통해서 활용할 여지는 분명히 갖고 있습니다. 그렇기 때문에 한국의 입장에서 보면 이 중러 관계, 이때까지는 미싱 링크, 저희가 별로 그렇게 중요하지 않게 생각을 했습니다만은 이제 미중 관계뿐만 아니라 러중 관계도 한반도에 굉장히 중요한 영향을 미칠 것이기 때문에 이제 우리가 어떻게 이런 데 대응해 나갈 것이냐. 이게 굉장히 이제 중요한 문제가 되고 있습니다. 그래서 이제 지금 우리 박근혜 정부가 주장하고 있는 동북아 평화 구상 또는 유라시아 이니셔티브는 이런 맥락에서 보면 이제 과거에 미국, 일본 이런 중요한 한미일 군사동맹 이 축도 굉장히 중요하지만 이제 이런 대륙의 축, 중국, 러시아와의 관계도 통일을 지향하는 한국의 입장에서는 이제 우리가 이제 좀 쉽게 볼 수 없는 굉장히 중요한 축이 되고 있습니다. 제가 조금 그 중요하게 동의하는 점은 지금 이 모든 대립의 근원에는 이 아이덴티티에 관한 문제입니다. 결국 아이덴티티에 관한 문제이기 때문에 이제 각국 한국, 중국, 일본, 러시아, 미국이 과연 어떤 아이덴티티를 고집하느냐 그거에 따라서 결국은 이 문제의 해답이 있을 수도 있고 영원히 이 문제 해답이 없이 굉장히 갈등만 악화되는 그런 상황도 될 수 있을 것 같습니다.
Okay, Professor. But actually, the searching for identity can create more problems. Because like if the identity cannot identities collide each other, I think there will be more problems. Actually, we have about 27 minutes, so I'd like to open the floor for questions. Because okay, then gentlemen in the first second row.
Ben Steele from the Council on Foreign Relations. This question is mainly for Dmitry, but I'd welcome Svetlana's comments as well. I wanted to talk a bit about how Russia perceives the collapse of the buffer zone it has established for itself after World War II between Russia and Germany. If you go back to the beginning of the Cold War in 1947 with the announcement of the Truman Doctrine, the Truman administration tried initially to contain the conflict with Russia to very aggressive economic diplomacy through the Marshall Plan. Stalin interpreted the Marshall Plan as being an inherently hostile act that the United States was buying political control in Europe, it was buying military bases, and the confrontation escalated very, very rapidly. So what was started as a pure economic track ultimately became a military track as well with the launch of NATO. Fast forward to the collapse of the Berlin Wall and the Soviet Union after 1989, and you seem to get parallel developments. That Russia's buffer zone begins collapsing on both dimensions. On the political, economic dimension, you have the expansion of the European Union eastward, and on the military dimension, you have the expansion of NATO. My question for you is, might it have been possible to avoid the current confrontation if that expansion had been limited to the economic political sphere through the European Union and the military sphere through NATO had somehow been avoided?
Okay, so I'd like to collect more questions and then ask the panelists to respond. And Richard, gentlemen. Yeah, in gray suit.
Yes, I have a question. If the panelists would reflect on the value of President Putin's inviting President Kim to come to the May Day meetings, we've heard different things in earlier sessions. I'd be curious in how the panelists assess the issue.
Okay, General Yao, lady in red.
First, I want to make a comment on. Russia-China relations, I think the improvement of the relations between our two countries is based on three aspects. The first is geographical or geostrategic considerations, because both countries are facing the pressure from United States, and there is a real need, a national interest consideration in the closing in the relationship. And the second reason is economic considerations, because we do have economy which are supplementary to each other, and both countries are looking forward to a drastic increase of trade values in the coming few years. And the third reason is also security consideration, that is, especially in the Central Asia area, and more recently, security cooperation is increasing in Western Pacific area. And personally, I'm looking forward to more security and defense military cooperation in Western Pacific area. I have a question for Gilbert. On your comment on the Russia-China relationship based on common communist identity. My question is, if Russia-China question relationship is based on a common communist identity, how do you explain the rivalry between China and the former Soviet Union during the Cold War, when the ruling parties of the two countries are communist parties, and now the ruling party in Russia is not communist party? And if the relationship is based on a common communist identity, how do you predict the future relationship between China, United States? And I think from your logic, it might be that a new Cold War is emerging between two civilizations. And I do agree with Dimitri that Russia is not part of the Chinese civilization, it's part of the Christian civilization. Thank you.
Okay, Ambassador Togo.
Thank you very much. It's such an interesting panel. I'm very grateful for the organizer. I have one question to Dimitri. Discussing the question of identity, I think it is in everyone's knowledge that there was two trends in Russian search for identity. One direction, Westerners, and another one, Slavophiles, which start from the period of Peter the Great. And now, if you take the post-Cold War Russian leaders, Gorbachev, Yeltsin, and Putin, in a rough manner, Gorbachev sided with the Westerners, Putin tried to be somewhere in between, and in my view, there's no secret that Yeltsin sided, tried to take both, and it is no secret that Putin was trying to create something of its own, something of Russianness. And in that context, I think what Gil mentioned is very telling, that Putin's shift towards China, is it not a reflection of search for its own Russian identity? And the second question I want to ask everyone, maybe to the Korean professor. There is only one country in the whole world which has the same problem as Russia, and this is Japan. And my view is that you have to look at Abe and Putin in that context. Japan is also divided into two identities from Meiji period onwards. For those who know Japanese history, understand it immediately. And Abe and Putin, in a way, stand in the same boat. And this opened a new civilizational direction of cooperation between Japan and Russia.
Okay. Now, I'd like to ask panelists to respond. Maybe I can ask Bill, like the Guild, to respond first, and then Dimitri, and then the...
Okay. Okay. I think the question from General Yao is one that I've thought a lot about. And a lot depends on how you interpret, not communist identity, the legacy of communist identity. Breaking it down into many dimensions. For instance, views of the Korean War. Chinese and Russian writings on the Korean War are very similar right now, blaming the West heavily in the predominant writings in both countries that I've been reading. That's just an example of an identity theme that is presented in terms of the view of the Cold War era in China has shifted much more towards pro what the Soviet Union was doing, and much more that the United States anti-communism caused more of the Cold War. So if I take it in terms of each of my many dimensions of identity, that's where I see the overlap. And I don't call it really communist. I call it the legacy of the themes of communism. Now, how did the Sino-Soviet split occur? There, identity became fixated on ideology.
and a narrow, very narrow interpretation of identity occurred for a period of time. I followed this very closely in the 70s and 80s. It could have been overcome in the 80s. There was a real opportunity for finding identity overlap on reform socialism that the two countries missed and I think deeply regret because the consequences were not desirable. So, and I don't have, in any way think Russia's part of Chinese civilization. I think Russia's insistent on its own civilization. But like China, it's a civilization that is defined these days heavily in opposition to Western civilization as the dominant mode. Now, I'll go to Togo-san's question because I think that that is very important because I also think that there is a potential for some kind of breakthrough between Abe and Putin. If Putin had not gotten so caught up in the Ukraine situation, I think those chances would have been much higher. I think they really did have, they both are rethinking, they're trying to look for re-entry into Asia. The potential for Japan to have a pivot would not so much depend on the United States, because I think Abe's fundamental identity problem is the US, even though it's manifested more as a South Korean-China problem right now. And of course, right now, he's doing everything he can to build up the US relationship. So I really think there's a potential, but Russia has to make some decisions to make that possible, and I don't see that happening, just as I don't see Russia doing things with South Korea to give the opening to South Korea. I think it would rather use the pressure of China, Russia against Japan, and North Korea being more supported by Russia to put South Korea in a tight bind, and that's where I see the emphasis on Russian policy these days.
Okay, thank you. Dmitry.
Thank you very much. I have four questions.
Yes.
First, your question. Thank you very much. It is a very fundamental issue because, indeed, we do have lots of comparisons between today's situation and 1940s, 1950s. As then, today we do not have rules, we do not have consensus about rules of the game, right? In 1940s, we at least had Yalta, but we interpreted Yalta differently. Today, we don't have even Yalta, right? We have a vacuum in terms of rules of the game, and it is a very dangerous situation. So one of my strongest recommendations for US-Russia relations is to elaborate rules of confrontation. And it would be very desirable for us to elaborate rules of confrontation without a second Cuban crisis, right? Which contributed to the liberation of the first Cold War rules. Now your question about whether the confrontation could be avoided if there were just the economic expansion of the Western orbit, not NATO. I don't think so, indeed. Well, for many years, Russia was quite inconsistent, especially in the 1990s, when Russia was in trying to avoid NATO expansion, Russia was artificially opposing a positive expansion of the European Union to negative expansion of NATO. Thus, I mean, many people in the West misunderstood, I mean, right? And I agree with Svetlana, there was no question of NATO expansion. After the Russian-Georgian War, it was simply taken off from the agenda. But already in the middle of the 2000s, Russia came to a conclusion that the expansion of the orbit of the European Union, not the European Union per se, because indeed there is no chance of the EU enlarging to Georgia, Ukraine, Moldova, I mean, forget about it for the observable future. But the orbit, the integrationist orbit of the European Union undermines the Russian grand strategy in the post-Soviet space because it excludes participation of those countries in the Russia-centric integrationist mechanisms. And as I said, there were many tactical issues that made this confrontation unavoidable, such as the US perception of Putin's Russia as the manifestation of wrong post-Cold War domestic and foreign policy development, the US perception of Russia as a weak and declining country, which does not matter much for the American interests, but is a minor, impediment and challenge for the US. The U.S. misperception of the protests in Moscow and St. Petersburg in 2011 and 2012, and I think wrong conclusion that Putin's regime is weak and relatively easy to be toppled down, and so on, so forth. So there were many misperceptions on the Russian side as well. But the point is that both military and economic expansion of the Western orbit, which again Russia perceived as a vigorous breakdown of the status quo that Russia was defending, resulted in this confrontation. Second question, Kim's visit to Moscow, the question by Richard Weitz. Russia regards that as an opportunity for Russia to promote its positive role in Asia-Pacific, to put some added value to the Russian pivot, right? How can Russia contribute to the Pacific issues? Security, right? Conflict resolution. Russia is a participant of the group of six negotiators about North Korea nuclear program. So this is a way for Russia to increase its leverage over Pyongyang and push Pyongyang more vigorously to the resolution. Russia is committed that engagement strategy will work rather than just the strategy of isolation of North Korea. So we regard it not as protection of Pyongyang and opposing North to the South, you know, some trilateral Russian-Chinese-North Korean alliance versus the American system of alliances. But on the contrary, the Russian positive contribution to the resolution of the North Korean nuclear issue. The question of China, you know, it is, again, I can't agree with Gilbert about Eurasian Union being a minor component of the Chinese greater economic belt of the Silk Road. It is a very unique and specific situation. First of all, these are fundamentally different things. Fundamentally different things. Eurasian economic integration is about integration. It is about pooling of sovereignty. It is about creating rules of the game, economic relations, customs union, common economic space, common economic policy, and so on and so forth. Chinese initiative on the economic belt of the new Silk Road is about infrastructure and about trade. So one is about integration in EU understanding of the term. The second is about trade, so they, and infrastructure. So they are very different, and this difference results in their compatibility. Another difference, fundamental difference between the Russian-Chinese collaboration in Central Asia and Russia-EU collaboration in our common neighborhood in the such as Ukraine. China has never demanded Central Asian countries to choose. Either you are with us or you are with Russia. Never. China promotes a different strategy that you are with both. Trade with China and participate in economic integration with Russia. It is fundamentally different from the European Union strategy. And finally, the question about identity. Simply can't fail to respond this. You know, there was a book by Alexander Rau, one of the German Russian experts, called A German in Kremlin, a book about Putin. A German in Kremlin, something to you about whether Putin is an anti-Western. Today, well, historically, during his presidency, Putin was one of the most pro-Western, to tell the truth, political figures in Russia. It was he who allowed, for instance, the deployment of the American bases in Central Asia, and so on and so forth. He supported a partnership with the Bush administration. Then he was fundamentally disencouraged, but nevertheless. Today, the Russian political elite about Ukraine consists of two camps. One is moderates, and this includes Putin, and the other is extremists, right, mm-hmm. and nationalists. And those are people that Putin tries to contain. This is why there is no full-fledged Russian intervention into Ukraine, because there are people in Moscow who say that now we need, you know, to openly, in a full-fledged basis, interfere, take, you know, Kyiv militarily, and so on and so forth, right? And turn Ukraine into by force into our satellites. Putin does not want that. He always searches for reconciliation with the West again on the terms and conditions that are appropriate for Russia. And final point: do not be misled about Eurasianism. The Russian idea of Eurasian Economic Union has nothing to do with Eurasianism as ideology. It is about economic integration, possibly about political integration. Russia would like to have political integration, also on the basis of economic integration. So far, it's not possible, but nevertheless. It is not about Eurasian, you know, Dugin-style ideology of Russia being a different civilization, distinct from the West. I mean, look, the U.S. also have anti-gay riots and demonstrations. I mean, the only difference with the West in terms of values that Russia has is political values.
Okay. Now, Svetlana, would you like to make some comments?
Yes.
Yes.
Very interesting question about economic versus military integration. This is what I started with, and I have to agree with Dmitry. I think most of you probably thought that we would disagree, but there are some points we agree on. I think that the economic integration has become threatening to Russia. But now, I think that we also have to look at not just what countries perceive as threatening, but what does make sense. For Ukraine, Russia hasn't been a good model to pursue. It just was on pragmatic reasons. You know, taking all the friendship and cultural ties aside, Russia is not serving as a good economic model. When you run a business, you want to have a strong rule of law, you want to have foreign direct investments, and you want to have certain rules that are predictable. And if we look at Poland, another neighbor of Europe, Poland have started with a lower per capita income when Soviet Union collapsed. Now Poland has three times higher per capita income. If we look at the levels of foreign direct investment in Central Eastern Europe, they are also several times higher than the one received in Ukraine. In Ukraine it was about 600, and in Czech Republic it was about 6,000. So I think that even looking at the figures, even when you interview businesses in Ukraine that have ties with Russia, Poroshenko, President Poroshenko, he has the candy business that actually sells a lot of candies to Russia. For some reason, his candies are not as popular in the Western capitals, but he was one of the ones who was propagating European integration before he became the president, right? He was the one who took the risks. And I think from the Ukrainian perspective, having Russia perceive economic integration with Europe as non-threatening one would be very, very beneficial. Actually, having kind of free trade among Europe and Russia would be a positive step for Ukraine. And in this regard, there's a point that I disagreed with Dmitry, and that is that Europe forced a choice. Europe didn't force a choice between free trade. Ukraine has had free trade with Russia, and the free trade now with Europe would actually not just open European markets, it would open also other markets, and it would not force Ukraine to not have free trade with Russia at all. What it would prevent is Ukraine potentially becoming a member of the Eurasian Union. But here you have to ask yourself, what does Ukraine want? Because actually Ukraine would want to have Yalta-type agreement. I think that's also another fundamental issue, is that what kind of global orders should weaker countries have? Now we have a lot of non-state actors, we have social media, we have also countries, weaker countries, that also want to have its interest to be taken into account. And countries such as Ukraine don't want to be decided upon over their heads. I think Korea, other countries wouldn't want that either. Yeah. And I remember when Yanukovych was still in power, he decided not to sign the association agreement. He flown to Moscow, had this loan agreement, and then was flying back. And I was following very closely the news and debates in Ukraine. And everyone seemed to be terrified. What the heck did he agree with Putin? Because everyone was afraid that he took the loan and agreed to Ukraine have signed the Eurasian Union. And that would really explode in the Ukrainian society. There are certain things that Ukrainians would not take. Ukrainians have different reactions from the one that Russians sometimes have. And that's why I think, just one small point, I think there's sometimes miscalculation on the part of a Russian regime about certain steps that could work in Ukraine, because they don't work the same way that they do in Russia. The whole idea of calculating what may work in the Ukrainian context based on what may work in Russian context just doesn't work. It's very different countries in that respect. And the Eurasian Union is just a no-go. However, the free trade and having good relationship would be definitely something to go for. Quickly, on the second question of North Korea, it's quite interesting because it's, I think, a positive step if Russia takes an active role in nuclear non-proliferation attempts. But I also have to remind you that Ukraine was actually one of the good examples of nuclear non-proliferation. If you remember, in 1994, Ukraine actually was one of the few states who've had one of the greatest nuclear arsenals, and it agreed to give up those for security assurances. And security assurances also came from Russia. And it's very, very unfortunate because what kind of message is it sent to countries like North Korea? By the way, you can come over here, but you know what? If you're going to be on the wrong side of the equation, if you're going to be a weak country and not have nuclear capability, someone may just invade you. You know, so I don't think that that's a positive step if we look at Ukraine as overall.
Okay.
And the last point on identity, because it was interesting, because I was just in eastern Ukraine, and I was also analyzing kind of the clips and the audio and video and all the statements by separatists. And it's interesting what I heard. It wasn't so much about, you know, there was a lot of Russia and flag of Russia when there was promotion and kind of separatist activity in some parts of eastern Ukraine. But one of the things that came out in my interviews was the idea that it was about the Soviet resurrection. And I was asking why. Why is the Soviet identity reinvigorated so much? And the answer was, well, because Russia can't attract itself to the current Russian regime. So people bring back the Soviet legacy because people used to have some, remember, good life under the Soviet Union. They were young back then, and who doesn't want to return to its youth? So I think the identity issue is also quite complicated.
Okay, so the legacy of the history matters a lot. So Professor Ohms, especially about this North Korean issue again, so what could be the positive role Russia can play, especially in the May Day? I don't know whether Kim Jong-un will show up. I doubt, but I don't know. So you can make a bet on that. So,
Medvedev 대통령 때 대외 정책을 저희가 한마디로 얘기하면 실용주의와 강대국 외교의 결합이었습니다. 근데 지금 푸틴 대통령의 대외 정책은 상당히 고립주의적이면서 기회주의적인 opportunistic isolationism을 갖고 있습니다. 그 이유는 이 실용주의적 요소가 상당히 약화되고 있기 때문입니다. 그 측면에서 보면 저희 한국의 입장에서 보면 이 아시아는 지금 지역 통합에서 가장 어려움을 겪고 있는 것이 이런 역사 문제라든지 이런 Asian paradox 때문에 이 regional integration이 상당히 어렵습니다. 지금 논의하고 있는 정도는 economic regional integration, political 얘기는 안 하기 때문에 근데 지금 러시아는 이 아시아에 통합되고 싶어도 이 아시아의 economic fundamental가 없습니다. foundation이 없습니다. 따라서 이 실용주의적 요소를 아시아에서 특히 미러관계를 우리가 좀 진정시키고 평화적인 관계로 발전시키기 위해서는 실용적 요소, 특히 러시아의 아시아에서의 경제적 파운데이션을 높여주는 그런 데에 미국도 굉장히 협력을 해야 합니다. 그런 측면에서 북러 관계의 최근의 개선은 그것을 어떤 반미적인 요소로 볼 것이 아니라 이런 프래그마티즘의 증진의 요소로 미국도 인식을 해야 됩니다. 그래서 이번에 김정은이 이제 뭐 모스크바를 방문하는 것을 단순히 북한과 러시아의 정치적인 유대 강화 또는 반미적인 전선의 강화 우리가 이렇게 인식하기보다는 북러 관계의 개선을 가급적 이 아시아에서의 경제적 인테그레이션의 확대의 요인으로 특히 한반도의 평화를 증진시키는 데 어떤 편승적 요인으로 우리가 될 수 있도록 미국이 굉장히 그것을 적극적으로 받아들여줘야 되고 더 장기적으로 보면 한국이 갖고 있는 유레이션 이니셔티브 여기에 지금 잘 되고 있지 못하는 근본적인 원인은 한반도의 남북관계 경색의 문제고 그래서 우리가 이 유레이션 이니셔티브가 잘 되는 가장 중요한 요소는 한반도관계가 잘 되는 게 아니라 미국이 이 정책을 하나의 아시아의 평화 증진 정책으로 받아들여주고 참여하는 데 성공의 요인이 있다고 생각합니다.
Thank you, Professor. Actually, your last point to highlight the theme of this plenum is a return of U.S. responsibility and to take the leadership. So it seems to me that as there's why we are a little bit more pessimistic about the future of U.S.-Russian relations, but we should not stop the hoping for the better opportunities. Maybe this is the time for us to have more in-depth dialogue and a straightforward dialogue, eye to eye, and kinds of
contribute to it.
Oh, of course.
Korea.
of course, actually, there should be more opportunity for strategic dialogue among the countries concerned, and also maybe Russia can play a more positive role, and also we will be sharing the responsibility in paving the way for peace and stability and prosperity in the region as well, not only in North East Asia, but also in the European continent. Please join me in thanking these panelists. I actually appreciate it. Thank you.